I'm out here a thousand miles from my home.
Bob Dylan. It is one of those names that describes more than a single person. It defines an era, a generation, and a moment when the idea of what a song could be changed forever. His canon is so full of historic songs that if he had lived in ancient times, scholars would still be arguing over whether it was possible that he was only one man, or if this name became a repository for all the great poets of his age, the way they argue about Homer, Ossian, and Shakespeare. He was and is the supreme musical voice of a people and a time. What we still do not know, what even he may not know, is, does he see himself as that voice? He was born Robert Zimmerman in 1941 in the hardscrabble mining town of Hibbing, Minnesota. Like his hero Woody Guthrie, he grew up among lives in ruin, but on the radio all he heard were confections, trivial songs that made no sense on the cold streets of Hibbing. Then he heard folk music.
He came to be as he is because things needed saying, and the young people were the ones who wanted to say them, and they wanted to say them in their own way. He somehow had an ear on his generation. I don't have to tell you, you know him, he's yours, Bob Dylan.
To him, folk was everything pop was not. It was human, real, mysterious. It was, he wrote in his memoir Chronicles, the stuff that could make you question what you'd always accepted, could litter the landscape with broken hearts, had the power of spirit. Folk songs were the way I explored the universe. He arrived in Greenwich Village in 1961. Folk music was everywhere, in the banjo buskers of Washington Square, in the hootenannies of Café Wa and the Gaslight, where he soon became a regular. He went to a Thelonious Monk rehearsal one day and shyly told the jazz legend he played folk music. Monk laughed, shook his head, said, "We all play folk music." In 1962, Dylan was signed to Columbia Records and almost immediately launched into one of the most productive periods in the history of American music or letters. Blowing in the Wind, Times They Are a-Changin', Hard Rains Are Gonna Fall, It Ain't Me, Babe, Mr. Tambourine Man, My Back Pages, With God on Our Side, were all written in the next 2 years. In 1965, Dylan went electric and the world shook. At the Newport Folk Festival that year, something happened, but people still argue fiercely about what it was. Some who were there insist he was booed off the stage. Others who were there insist he was not. Some say the consternation was about his electric sound. Others say it was about how briefly he played. What is known is that he performed every song he intended and that he was brought back for two encores. After that, however, he certainly was booed by folk fans who felt betrayed by this new Dylan. But to dismiss this as an argument about what kind of guitar he used is to trivialize both the folk world of that day and the importance of what Dylan did by going rock. It was the direction more than the volume that folkies objected to. A popular complaint back then was, he's writing me songs, not we songs. But to Dylan, folk music was about everything human, the life around us and the life within us. He would be troubadour to all of it. Dylan was not the first to fuse folk and rock, but when he went electric, he fundamentally transformed both genres. He was not the first to fuse folk rock with country music, but when he made his 1969 album Nashville Skyline, everyone knew that country music would never be the same. These days, Dylan is more open about himself, yet still inscrutable. Is that a grin or a grimace beneath that skinny mustache? What's in those eyes now? Anger or merely mischief? But he seems closer to those honest, open-armed hootenanny days of his, that rambling spirit and feverish love of all things folk. Maybe he's just coming full circle, as most of us do in our third acts. Maybe he's again riding some wave that only he can see yet. And maybe he never left those folk roots. Not really. Not as much as we thought. Not in his haunted heart, or in the strange visions that still inhabit his songs, somehow both mystical and visceral, surreal and harrowingly human. And so the same question remains with the mystery that is Bob Dylan. Is he keeping secrets, or is he revealing them? Or could it be, somehow, that he is doing both, and always has been?
And I'll stand on the ocean until I start sinking. But I'll know my song well before I start singing. And it's a hard, it's a hard, it's a hard, and it's a hard rains are gonna fall.